not a man that he should lie, neither the son of man that he should repent. Have he said it? And shall he not do it? If God spoke it, he will make good on his promise. All he wants us to do is to believe it. All he wants us to do is not give up, to stand on his promise, to remember his promise. Amen. God is in charge of every situation in our lives. Or is he? Is he? Mm-hmm. The question is, have you taken over God's charge? We know that God is in charge of our situation, but sometimes I think we take the place of God. Am I the only one got my hand up? Sometimes I've tried to do some things that God has said, sit down somewhere, set yourself down somewhere. I got it. I'll get it done if you get out of the way. But has God taken, have we taken over God's charge? Amen. Have we taken over the responsibility that God has said he would do? Amen. I think a lot of times we don't get what we want because we're trying to do it. Instead of us doing what we're supposed to do, we're doing what God is supposed to do. Amen. Am I just talking to myself this morning? Are we doing what God should be doing for us? Let's think about that. Are we doing it? Are we waiting on God? Anybody ever tried to do something besides me and just was a struggle? Just was a struggle. You wondering what in the world is going on? You in the way. God has said when you get out of the way, I can do what you've asked me to do. You know, we ask God to do things. And then we get the pencil out, the paper, and we're trying to figure it out. All on our side, we done came up with our A plan, our B plan, and our C plan. You know, God's only got one plan for us. Amen. But we say, okay, A don't work. Let's go to the B plan. Go to the C. And every time you move these plans around, they get smaller and smaller. You might have started up here believing God for Mercedes Benz. You stay on the bus stop, so God, I just take anything, got some wheels on it. But is that God's best? You know, God wants us to have his very best. He wants us to have his very best. God just don't want to give us no anything that's going to break down on the road when we get down the road. Amen. God wants us to have his very best. Hallelujah. Oh, God, I thank you this morning for your best. So let's consider the text today. Hebrews. The book of Hebrews is a group of Christians who were once under the Judaism religion. That's what the book of Hebrews is all about. This group of Hebrew Christians were considering returning back to Judaism due to persecution from some Jews and the Romans. You would have thought, here these Christians were, they came out of Judaism, but they got their own people trying to pull them back. Instead of pushing them forward, they were trying to pull them back. Just like we got some folks in our own life right now. Instead of pushing us, they're trying to pull us back because they're scared we're going to move past them. Amen. Let me tell you about the Judaism religion. The Judaism religion was one that expressed true worship and devotion to God. Now, this wasn't no second-rate religion at all. Judaism was the oldest religion around. Amen. They believed that God revealed himself through the prophets. And he did. They worshiped in their synagogues and their spiritual leaders were rabbis. They believed in the covenants of the Old Testament. They had their own holy books and their own holidays. The Orthodox Jews observe the traditional Jewish laws and rituals. The Jews were into laws that were written out for them. They were into rituals. They heavily believed in obeying the Ten Commandments. Paul, who was one of the authors of the book of Hebrews, was a Jew. But we know Paul was converted to Christianity and became an apostle, an incredible apostle for Jesus Christ. how wonderful Paul was and the work that he did. But God is still God. Then Christ came. What did he do? He came to fulfill the law and the prophets, conquering sin and freely providing eternal life. Now here these Jews was. They'd been raised a Jew since they were babies, since they were children. They knew all of the rituals. They followed all of these 613 or more different laws. This is what they were taught. Now here comes Jesus saying, we ain't got to do all of that. You can still come to me, although you fornicate. You can still come to me, although you commit adultery. You can still come to me, although you lie. You can still come to me and be saved. Some of the Jews, the Hebrew Jews, were confused. They were confused. And could not accept the message of Jesus Christ. They could not believe it was that easy to have eternal life. Because remember, they raised up on all these rules and all these rituals. They could not believe that Jesus could make it this easy for them to have eternal life. This is what they believed in the Old Testament. The high priest represented the Jew. So they were all seeing. They were about what they could see and what they could touch. Some of the Jews did not accept Jesus Christ, found themselves slipping back into the old and familiar. Nobody likes change. Change is not easy. Change is hard. Right now on my job, we're going through reorganization, people being laid off, people being put in new positions. But through all that, I got a promotion. God is still God. Whatever he promised you, God promised me a promotion a year before I got the promotion. Didn't even know my company was getting ready to go through a reorganization. So it don't matter whatever God promised you. It don't matter what's going on in the earth. The spiritual realm is still blessing God's people. So here these Jews were. They were having a hard time with it. They were being persecuted. They were trying to understand what Paul was saying and what others were saying about Christianity and how the church was established in the book of Acts. They were trying to understand all of this. Not that what they were doing was wrong, but Christ came to free us all out of bondage. We as Christians have to be very careful about going back to something God has taken us out of. Now, this is what the Jewish were getting ready. God had brought them out of something to take them to better, but because it was unfamiliar, they wanted to step back. They wanted to step back into what was familiar. How many times have we been in a struggle and we want to say, you know what? Forget it. This is too hard. This is too hard. Trying to get a house is too hard. So God, you know what? I'm okay in this apartment. You know, I'm okay, God. Because we don't want to save and we don't want to budget. We don't want to strategize to get to where we're trying to go. We take a step back and say, you know what? That's all right. God, I'm good. How many of y'all told God that besides me? God, I'm good. This is too hard. This is too hard. We have to be careful going back to something that God has brought us out of. Because guess what? It's not going to be the same. We can't go back to the club. It's not the same. They ain't doing the funky chicken no more. They're doing all kind of stuff right now. If you look at TV, if we go back to the club, now all kind of stuff is going on. We'd be like, Lord, have mercy. What is going on up in here? There's things going on in the club that's supposed to go on between married people in the bedroom. There's so much stuff going on now. Hallelujah. It's so much stuff. So we have to be careful going back to something that God has brought us out of. Sometimes we're not as strong as we think we are. And we're dibbling dabbling and stuff. Amen. If you are alcoholic, it may not be time for you to go get your friends as alcoholic. You got to make sure you're straight. You got to make sure you've been delivered. You got to make sure that you're done with alcohol. Because guess what? They can pull you back in. They can pull you back into a drinky drink. Hallelujah. So if God brought you out of something, stay out of it. Stay out of it till God say, go back in it. God said, go back and get your friends. Go back and get your kinfolk. You got to make sure Because the devil ain't playing with neither one of us. Amen. The devil is actually mad right now that we in church. He's actually mad, guess what? Because we got away. He's mad right now because we got away. Amen. He still wanted to hold on to us. Amen. So we got to be careful going back. Amen. Into what God has brought us out of. And wait for God to give us permission. Amen. Let's talk about the book of Hebrews was written to show how Christ is superior. And even the angels and Moses and the high priest. Amen. The Jews believed heavily in the Old Testament, but rejected Jesus as the long-awaited Messiah. And I was studying this morning. They knew the Messiah was coming. But because Jesus didn't come the way they thought he should have came, they rejected him. Amen. Sometimes our blessing not going to come the way you think it's going to come. But guess what? It's going to come. Amen. It's going to come. We got to hold on and let God do it the way he wants to do it. Amen. It's not going to come in the timing that God wants it to come in. Amen. We thought we should have had it 2 years ago, but God said, no, not so. Now is the time. Amen. Now is the time. In the first chapter of Hebrews, the writer first deals with the angels. The writer explains that the angels are servants and not the Savior. The letter also dealt with the danger of drifting away. He talked to these Jews about drifting away. Chapter 2, verse 1 says, therefore, we ought to give the most earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. So many people have lost their faith, changed their minds, turned another way, and even stopped because of what somebody else said. Hallelujah. Some people have lost their faith. They were believing God for something till they talked to their sister, till they talked to their mama, till they talked to their friend. Girl, I'm playing. Why do we have to check with our friends to do something when that God has already told us to do? We want to run it by our friends as soon as they say something negative. But because we love them, respect them, maybe I shouldn't do that right now. We're in the middle of a pandemic. I'm hearing all kind of incredible testimonies. Guess what? In the middle of a pandemic. I've never seen people so blessed. Hallelujah. In the middle of a pandemic. Whatever God promised you, he's still God. You're going to get it. It don't matter whether it's a storm going on, whether it's a layoff, the unemployment rate is up high. It don't matter what's going on in your household, your life. Whatever God said he's going to do for you, he's going to do it. So what we got to do is not change our mind, not turn around, and not stop. Amen. Because of what we hear. Let me tell you something. The devil is on assignment to discourage you. Whatever it is that you're trying to do, there's somebody waiting in the wings to try to discourage you. Amen. Hallelujah. But we got to hold on to what God told us, because God supersedes any voice that man has. Amen. Amen. We listen. We listen to the wrong people and miss the opportunities that God has for us. Anybody have missed any opportunities beside me? Yeah, I listen to some folk. I'm not just talking to you. I'm talking the pulpit to the back door. I missed some opportunities. Listen to the wrong folk. Listen, how you going to do that? How you going to get that done? You know, it wasn't up to me to get it done. It was up to God to get it done. Amen. So I want to ask you, who is that person? Who is that person you listening to? Who's hindering you? Shame on them. And shame on you for listening to them. And not the voice of God. Because sometimes we get ideas, we get dreams, and we want to set goals. Ask God. Make sure it's the voice of God. Because as humans, you know, we can come up with some stuff. I'm going to do this. I want to do that. I can accomplish like, but ask God. Let me tell you something. Include God in your plans. Amen. But don't have your plans so tight that God can't come in and change them. Amen. Hallelujah. The Jews were also told to listen to God and not harden their hearts. Don't harden your heart. Amen. To the plan that God has for you. The Jews learned in the book of Hebrews that Jesus Christ is and will always be the high priest. But still, to the Jews, the high priest was the highest religious authority in the land. The high priest was the only one who could enter the holies of holies once a year and make atonement for the sins of the entire nation. This was in Leviticus 16. This is why the Jews respected the high priest. The Jews did not understand that they did not have to wait for the high priest once a year, that they could come boldly unto the throne of grace, obtain mercy, and find grace to help in the time of need. We don't have to wait, thank God, for the priest once a year to make atonement for our sins. We can go to God right now. Right where you said, we can go to God right now. We can go boldly. He's already given us permission. Amen. We don't have to wait for a human being. Amen. So we thank God, because guess what? He's still God. He's still God. So much was explained to the Christian Jews in chapter 13 of Hebrews. This book was wrote as a comparison and not a replacement for what the Jews had already been taught. Paul and others wrote this book. It wasn't just specifically Paul. So what they did, they compared what the Jews already knew with Christ. They met him where they are. Don't God meet us just where we are? He meets us just where we are. So they compare. They didn't tell the Jews, dismiss what you learned. Forget about what you learned. Paul didn't try to brainwash them. He just compared what they already knew to Jesus Christ's way of doing things. Amen. The book of Hebrews deals with what was familiar to the Jews, such as Melchizedek. His name is mentioned. They're familiar with him. Abraham, the covenant. They believed in the covenant. The rules of worship. Jesus being the perfect offering of sin and the sacrifice of sin. The Hebrews 11 talks about the heroes of faith. All of these people the Jews are familiar with. Amen. They were familiar with Moses. Amen. Paul put all of this together with leaders that they already respected. Amen. Paul was a smart man, and God used him to help people. Amen. This letter was letting the Hebrews know, you were serving me all the time. That's why it had to be tied in, that what they were doing wasn't new. Because Jesus Christ is the Father, the Son, amen, amen. He was letting them know, I was there all the time. I was God in the flesh. God was there yesterday. Hebrews 13 today. He was there today and forever. Amen. Genesis, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. He was there all the time. So he had to calm the minds of the Jews, the Christian Jews that had been converted, to let them know God was there all the time. And I want to say to you today, people of God, God was there all the time. When you messed up, he was there. Before you got saved, he was there. He seen it before you did it. He heard you. He seen you. He's there all the time. Amen. He's not holding what you did yesterday against you today. He's the God of yesterday. He's the God of today. And he's the God of forever. He knows we're going to mess up tomorrow. He knows we're going to mess up next week. And God is ready to forgive us. Amen. I love this book of Hebrews. Amen. Where God is reminding us, as he reminded the Jews, I am the God of yesterday. I'm the God of today. I'm the God of forever. And God is saying, whatever I said to you, whatever I said, I'm still going to do it. I'm not holding it against you. Amen. God is a good God. And he's still God. He's still God. Amen. Can we clap our hands? Because God is still God. Amen. He has not changed. God said we're not going to be able to call him a liar. Whatever promise he made in this book, he's going to do it. God is big and bad enough to do it. It don't matter what sickness, what disease, what you've been through now, what you're coming out of, what you're about to go in through. God is still God. God can do what he says he's going to do. Like I said, I just came to remind someone today, if he did it yesterday, he'll do it today. If God has healed you before, he can heal you again. Each time should increase our faith, right? It should increase our faith. I remember in 1995, I had went home and buried my father in September 1995. I went home and I came back maybe a couple of months later. I got a physical, my yearly physical. And the doctor told me that I had a hyperactive thyroid. I had a hyperactive thyroid. And I knew what that was because my mother had that as a child, that I understood the effects of a hyperactive thyroid, how with my mother it went from a hyperactive thyroid to heart problems. She ended up having a heart attack at 46 years old. So I knew what that was. The doctor was going to give me a prescription. And I said, no, I don't think I'm going to be needing it. He said, well, no, you need this prescription. I said, I don't think so. I said, well, how long am I supposed to take this to fix this? Well, pretty much the rest of your life. I said, oh, no. I didn't like taking pills. Still don't like taking pills. So I said, no, I won't be needing it. He said, well, okay. If you change your mind, call my office, and I'll get my receptionist to get you a prescription over to the pharmacy. So I said, oh, okay, but I don't think I'll be needing it. He said, but I want you to come back every 3 months, and I want to check your thyroid to see if it's gotten any worse. So 3 months later, made an appointment, went back, hadn't gotten no worse, hadn't gotten no better. He's still trying to write me a prescription. And I said, no, I don't think I'm going to be needing it. He said, why do you keep telling me that you don't need it? I said, because God's going to heal me. My faith began to kick in because within them 3 months, I began to read Hebrews 11, and I began to see how God had healed people. And I said, God, did you heal them? Remember, he's the same God yesterday, today, and forever. So I knew God was going to heal. I had convinced myself through the word of God. I said, God, you're going to heal me. I'm not going to need this medicine for the rest of my life. Because one thing about medication, you take it long enough, that one medication that's supposed to help your thyroid don't start messing with your heart and all this other kind of stuff. Amen? So I went back. Second visit, he's saying, I'm going to write you a prescription. I said, no, sir, you don't have to write. Well, okay, Angela, if you change your mind, call my reception. And I'll have them get you a prescription over to the pharmacy. I said, okay. He said, I'll see you in 3 months. He said, okay, I'll see you in 3 months. Got ready to go back to the doctor. 3 months later, made an appointment on a Wednesday. That Sunday, I had went to church. At that time, we was at Gospel Tabernacle. We was at Gospel Tabernacle. And at that time, we didn't normally have an evening service. This was in 1996 by this time. We didn't normally have an evening service. But I remember the pastor said, I feel an unusual anointing to have a 6 o'clock night service for those that want to be healed. Woo! This was on a Sunday. I had a Wednesday appointment. Hallelujah. So God said, I need you to get to that healing service because I need to turn the negative report around into a positive report. So I got to the church that night. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I got to the church that night. I got in the prayer line. Amen. I went up with my hands up. And I remember the pastor looking at me. I didn't even tell him what I needed. Didn't have to. All he said to me, he said, you're getting ready to know God like you've never known God before. He touched me and I went out under the power of God. And I claimed my healing that night. I went to the doctor on Wednesday and he's checking and he's looking. He says, I can't see that you have a thyroid problem anymore. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. That that increased my faith. And I know whatever come my way, God's going to heal me. Hallelujah. God's going to heal me. Amen. Hallelujah. And I did not know that same faith I was going to need it years later for my grandson. There was two situations. I have an 18-year-old grandson right now. They told us, the first thing they told us, I think he was a year old, and he used to walk and his feet would come together. His parents, my son, and his mother took him to St. Jude. You know, St. Jude is recognized across this country as one of the most wonderful hospitals. St. Jude told them, in order for him to walk right, we're going to have to break his legs. I said, the devil is a liar. And put braces on his legs. And I told them, I said, no, they're not going to break his legs. Bring him to me. So they brought him to the house. I kept him all week long. The house we were living in, I had a prayer room. And I took him in that prayer room. And I got that oil. And I went to work. I was praying. I said, God, you're the same God yesterday. You're the same God today. You're the same God forever. And I was in that prayer closet. His legs were dripping wet with oil. And I was praying. I said, God, you heal me. And I know you can heal him. His legs were just dripping wet. And I was praying. And he was like, oh, what you doing, G-Mom? I said, I'm praying, baby, you're about to get healed. You are about to get healed. Let me tell you, took him back to the doctor. They took him back to St. Jude. And they changed their mind. They said, well, his legs don't look as bad as they used to. We believe if you take him on home, his legs are going to straighten out. And they took him on home. And he's 18 years old. He's played basketball. He's played football. And he's walking like he's supposed to be walking. I'm telling you, God is a good God. Whatever promise he made in these 66 books, God has got to do what he said. The thing about God, we can hold him to his word. Hallelujah. Hey, God, I thank you. Y'all know that by this time, the devil is mad at me, right? He's spitting mad at me, right? So my grandson, 2 years later, by this time he's 3 years old. You know, the devil, when he can't get you, he coming for your kids. He'll even come for your grandkids. You know, he don't fight fair. He come for what you love. Amen. And he know I love my grandson. He was my first grandson. And so 2 years later, by this time he's 3 years old. Amen. And I'm telling you, the devil, amen, was mad at me. And I wasn't crazy about him either. Hallelujah. So when my grandson was 3 years old, it's the funniest thing. Every time they'd bring him to spend the weekend with me, we'd bring him into the church. And his ears would hurt. His ears would hurt. He couldn't stay in the sanctuary because of the microphones. And I said, y'all need to take him to the doctor. Take him to the doctor. And they were saying that he was going deaf. He wasn't going to be able to hear. Amen. They were telling us, I said, the devil is a lie. I said, oh, he will hear. He will hear. They were getting ready, I think, to put some plugs or something in his ear. They were getting ready to put some plugs in his ear. And I told them, I said, he not going to need that. But mama, this is my son, mama, we got to do what the doctor say. I said, we are going to do what the doctor said, Dr. Jesus, not Dr. Maxwell or whatever his name was. I said, I know a different kind of doctor. His plan can't fail. He can't fail. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. If he healed me, if he healed Dwayne the first time, he can heal again. So they were getting ready. I don't know what's wrong with Wednesday. On a Wednesday, they were getting ready to put these plugs. Hallelujah. I'm familiar with Wednesday. They were getting ready to put these plugs on his ears, in his ears on a Wednesday. I said, bring him to me before the doctor's appointment. Brought him to church that morning. He couldn't stay in the sanctuary. I took him to children's church. Back there, they didn't have microphones, so he could stay back there. It was time now for the prayer. I think I was ushering that day. I left my post running. I said, now my grandson is about to get healed. Now is his opportunity. He's about to get healed. Today is his day. He got a Wednesday appointment and the doctor needs to see that he don't need any plugs in his ears. Hallelujah. I went and got him. He's 3 years old. He said, G-Ma, what are you talking about? We got to go in the sanctuary. No, G-Ma, I can't go in there. My ears are going to hurt. I said, baby, I got to help you. I'm trying to help you. So I got him to the altar. I'm running. I'm carrying him to the altar. I get to the altar. They asked me, what are you here for? I said, he needs his ears to be healed. Because I heard that Jesus opened blinded eyes. I heard that he opened ears. I said, I need his ears to be healed. So he got in the prayer line. The same pastor that he prayed. The same pastor that prayed for me prayed for my grandson. And he looked at me. He said, God is instantly getting ready to heal one of his ears. And he'll heal the other one over time. I said, God, I thank you. And I began to praise God. Got to the doctor's appointment on Wednesday. The doctor went in. They're getting ready to put these plugs. Hallelujah. Glory to your name, God. They're getting ready to put these plugs in his ear. So they want to check him one more time. So they looked inside of his ears. Before they had said, when they look in his ears, it looked like fire. It was about red as Minister Newicki's blare. This time on a Wednesday, when they looked again, it was normal. So I said, God, I thank you. So I just came to tell somebody that God will do just what he said. God will heal. God will deliver. God will do just what he said. All we have to do is believe. We can't shake. We can't waver. We can't believe God on Sunday. Then by Monday, you say you don't know what to do. We got to have that continual faith. We got to have that Hebrews 11 faith like God said. Whew. So I would encourage somebody. Keep on setting your goals. And also know that goals will disappoint you if you leave God out of them. Keep on setting your goals. But don't just rely on goals. Rely on God. Hallelujah. God has a promise for every situation in our lives. God has us covered. If you don't believe me, pick up these 66 books. There's not a situation in your life that God can't handle. There's nothing too hard for God. These hard-headed kids, these hard-headed grandchildren we got running around here, I said nothing is too hard for God. Keep on praying. Keep on praying. Keep on telling them they're millionaires. Keep on telling them they're going to preach the word. I don't care what they're doing. Hallelujah. Keep on telling them. The Bible says in Exodus 23 in my close, 23 and 25, and ye shall serve the Lord God, and he shall bless thy bread and thy water, and I will take sickness away from the midst of thee. Hallelujah. God will take sickness out of your body. God will get you off of those five prescriptions. Amen. Hallelujah. But y'all know sometimes we got to do our part. You know, we got to stop eating bacon. We got to put the pork down. We got to do our part. Amen. Hallelujah. Because, you know, we don't eat like the folks in the Bible eat. We just eat all kind of stuff now, y'all. God said, if you're hungry, Luke 9 and 14, God fed 5,000 people. 5,000 people. He will feed the hungry. If you need help, Psalms 46 and 1 said, God is our refuge and strength, a very pleasant help in trouble. How many of you know before we leave this earth, we're going to be in some trouble and we're going to need God to get us out of trouble? He said he would be a very present help. Y'all know we're going to be in some situations sometimes money can't buy. There's some people right now in the hospital got corona. Their money ain't no good. But the true and living God is still healing and he's not charging. I can imagine people are in the hospital, leaving the hospital. $50,000, $100,000. People standing there for months over COVID. But what if they would have stopped and called on the name of the true and living God? They may not have had a hospital bill. Hallelujah. God is not slack concerning his promises. If you need finances, 3 John 1 and 2 says, beloved, I wish above all things that thou mayest prosper and be in health, even as thy soul prospered. God don't mind us prospering. God don't mind us having the money. He just don't want the money to have us. We still got to do what God says for us to do. And somebody may need love today. God already got us covered. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. God gave his only son to be beat, whipped, ridiculed, betrayed. I got one son. I don't know if I could have did it. I'm glad God didn't ask me to do it. Because a mother couldn't stand by like Mary and watch their child be beat, spit on. I'm glad he didn't ask me to do it. And I'm glad he didn't ask you to do it either, because you guys have children too. But God is a good God. But whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. We shouldn't be in lack. We shouldn't be discouraged. We have the God of the universe on our side. So I just came today to encourage somebody, to let you know, Hebrews 13 and 8, that God is the same yesterday, today, and forever. The Jews had to find this out. And Paul did an incredible job of doing a comparison of what they already knew to draw them to Christianity. So I just want to say to someone today, continue to believe God. I don't care how long it's been. I don't care if it's been 20 years. I don't care if nothing looks like what God said. It won't. A lot of times, it won't look like what God said. It'll look just the opposite. And you trying to figure out, God, how in the world are you going to do this? My credit is tore up from the blow up. But he promised you a house. My children are running amok. But he promised you they're going to serve God. I was looking at my own son. He came by the house last night. He's going to serve God. He's got to take this mantle. I don't have another child. He's going to preach to God. I don't care what he say or what he do. He's going to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm not serving God and doing all of this and my son be lost, and his children, my grandchildren, be lost. The devil is alive. And before I leave this earth, I'm going to see him with a mic in his hand. Hallelujah. I believe God. I believe God. Because guess what? I'm seeing God. I'm seeing it. It used to be worse. There was a period he wasn't coming by the house. I believe God that he's going to do everything that God said he's going to do. And I'm not giving up. I'm not giving in. I don't care what he says, what he does, but I'm watching God. Like I said, he's 38 years old. And we're talking now more than ever. More than ever, I'm watching God. I'm watching God drawing him in. That was even a time we didn't even get along. But that's all right. I still prayed for it. I still believe God. I said, God, you're going to turn it around. And I see God. I see God turning it around. Not only for me, I see God turning it around for you, First Lady. Minister Vicky, I see God turning it around for you. Brother and Sister Allen, I see God. Turning around for you. Sister Janice, you've been praying. You've been praying. I see God turning it around for you. My sister, I see God turning it around for you. Brother New Wiki, I see God turning it around for you. sister in the back, I don't know all of y'all, but I see God turning it around for you. Woman of God, I see God turning it around. Don't worry. Don't worry. I see God turning it around. Woman of God, I see God turning it around. Minister Beverly, it's already done. Oh, you're just in the praising phase right now.